We have many genes. Inactivating genes often has consequences at the cellular level or the whole organism level. But there are ways that genes communicate and affect one another. And there are two extremes of this interaction. One called synthetic lethality. Here, the cell may lose the activity of gene A and still be okay without pathology, without any phenotype. In some cases, you delete gene B. That is also the case. But in synthetic lethality, if a cell loses both gene A and gene B, this can lead to a pathology or a disease or even death. The other end of the extreme is when a gene A defect causes disease, causes death at the cellular level or a disease at the whole organism level. And this genetic principle, which has been around since the 1930s through studies in Drosophila and worms and yeast, is that gene B, knocking out gene B, actually alleviates a disease state caused by a gene A defect. There are many ways biochemically to explain these genetic interactions that we're now understanding, but they're very, very common in biology. And what I'm going to talk about today is how my work in DNA repair has highlighted how we can use this genetic interaction to understand DNA repair pathways, but also to identify a new way of treating cancer. And if I get time at the very end of my talk today, I'm just going to highlight how I think about this other principle may be very effective to think about ways of treating human genetic diseases. So what I'm going to share with you is a journey, a personal journey, which started 25 years ago. I used to say this was I think I'm going the wrong way. Yes, writing here goes from this direction to this direction, which is different in the UK, and ended up with this compound here, which is a new cancer treatment called olaparib. Okay. So my focus is on DNA repair mechanisms. I trained in the US in a lab studying gene expression, transcription, but I found that through chance observations, my whole research career moved into studying DNA repair. It was nothing I planned. It was not a deliberate course. It was just simply following the science and seeing where the science took me. And the science, I guess my destiny so far, has been in the realm of DNA repair, but I did not know this in the early 1990s. So my lab focuses on DNA repair and DNA damage processes. It turns out, as you all know, we have many, many cells. We start out with one cell. These develop and divide into the approximately 10 to the 13 or 10 to the 14 cells that makes up a single human being. Every cell in our body has a full complement of DNA that we inherited from our mother and father. And every cell in our body, essentially every cell in our body, has around 5 times 10 to the 9 base pairs of DNA. So still, I think this is an amazing fact. I've known this fact for many, many years. But if you take the DNA from a single human cell and stretch it end to end, it would be approximately 1.5 to 2 meters, which means in a single human being has enough DNA, if you stretched end to end, would go to the sun and back 550 times. We have a huge amount of DNA in our body. That DNA is the genetic information. It's normally doing the right thing. It's instructing our cells to do the correct things. But of course, mistakes can occur in the DNA sequence. They can arise through the polymerases copying the DNA wrongly, or trying to copy the DNA when it's been damaged. And that can lead to mutations. And we know that mutations affect the function of cells. And one severe consequence of that can be cancer. The major drivers of cancer are mutations. And in the end, when somebody dies of cancer, that is normally just because one of these cells, one out of the 10 to the 14 cells, has got enough mutations of the right kind to cause that cancer to end up killing the person. So I think it's amazing. Cancer occurs quite commonly. Maybe in 1 in 2 or 1 in 3 people will get cancer. But when you think of it at the molecular level, it's tremendously rare. And that's mainly because our bodies, our cells are equipped with many, many systems that recognize DNA damage and repair the DNA damage to stop mutations occurring. Because it turns out that the DNA in our bodies is continually being challenged by a range of agents. ultraviolet light from the sun, chemicals in the environment, but also chemicals generated within our own bodies cause a huge amount of DNA damage. So we have many different DNA damaging agents, we have many different types of DNA damage, and we have many systems for repairing forms of DNA damage. So if I were to switch the lights off and one person was to sit in this room away from radiation sources, not exposed to the sun, just because of endogenous metabolism, every cell in that person would be receiving approximately 100,000 DNA lesions per day. So even at rest, the human body has to repair this number of DNA lesions per day. And if we could not repair and recognize those lesions, our cells would very quickly cease to function and we'd die. Okay. So it turns out that through work in my lab and many labs over the years, we've learned that there are many different DNA repair systems that recognize the DNA damage and repair it. And it turns out that different DNA repair systems are dedicated to different forms of DNA damage. So double strand breaks, which are the most toxic form of DNA damage, are repaired by certain systems that I'll talk about today. But there are other different systems for repairing DNA damage. For example, ultraviolet light. If you're exposed to a midday sun in Saudi Arabia for 1 hour, every cell that's receiving sunlight will get from sunlight approximately 100,000 lesions per hour. This DNA damage is repaired by a very dedicated system called nucleotide excision repair. And this is a different system than is used for double strand breaks. So different DNA repair is repaired by different systems. Okay. So my lab is particularly interested in double strand breaks. This is the most toxic form of DNA damage. The two strands of the DNA double helix are broken, and that means the two ends can move apart, and that makes double strand break repair very difficult to occur within the cell. It turns out there are two main systems for repairing double strand breaks in all of our cells. One of these I'll talk about a little bit more at the beginning. This is a system that my lab characterized over the last 20 years. The other system is important because it involves proteins such as BRCA1 and BRCA2, and I'll talk about those a little bit later on, because it's this system that we take advantage of to treat certain cancer patients. Okay. So we've known for many, many years that defects in DNA repair, either through inheritance or newly acquired mutations in these systems, give rise to disease in people. We know this also in model organisms, yeast, Drosophila, C. elegans, mouse. But we know that humans who have defects in these pathways have a range of different pathologies. And perhaps most notably are cancer. But we're also increasingly seeing that there are developmental defects, immune deficiencies, neurodegeneration, and aspects of premature aging occurring because of DNA repair defects. But for the last 20 years, my lab is mainly focused on cancer for a number of reasons. But later on, I'll just mention that we're also now studying a range of other diseases. So out of this study, we hope to get insights into cell biology, how our cells recognize DNA damage, how the DNA damage is repaired. But we're also hoping that out of this new knowledge will become therapeutic applications. Of course, to treat disease, it helps to know what the disease is starting from. And if you understand the basics of the disease, maybe we can come up with better medicines for treating diseases such as cancer. So very briefly, I won't go into this in detail, we know that DNA repair mechanisms are of huge importance for cancer. We know that DNA damage can give rise to mutations, and we know that mutation causes cancer. We know that certain patients with inherited defects in the DNA damage response predisposed to cancer. Very good examples of this are mutations in BRCA1 and BRCA2, but there are many other examples. We also know that besides surgery, the main therapies still today used for cancer rely on causing DNA damage. So chemotherapy, radiotherapy, they kill cancer cells by causing too much DNA damage in the cancer cell, so the cancer cell dies. But of course, the side effects, radiotherapy and chemotherapy, are caused by DNA damage generated in the normal cells. We also know that there's potential for DNA damage markers to be used in cancer diagnostics and maybe patient stratification. But as I'll touch on in my talk, understanding these DNA repair pathways have also identified various targets, drug targets, that we think can be exploited to develop new cancer therapies.
Oh, sorry, that's... I think I clicked the button a little bit too much there.
Okay, so with that as a backdrop, I just want to really go through a personal journey that started 25 years ago. Before I do that, I just want to highlight the fact that our cells contain many, many proteins. So this is a piece of broken DNA here. We know there are certain proteins recognize the DNA damage. These are, if you like, are molecular policemen. They patrol the nucleus looking for broken DNA. When broken DNA occurs, they recognize, they bind to the DNA damage, and then trigger a range of processes within the cell. These include DNA repair, but they also do a range of other things, such as controlling cell division, cell growth, also influencing other activities. So through my work and work in many other labs, hundreds of labs now, when I started in the DNA repair area, it was a fairly small field, but as everything in the world now, everything's much more complicated, and there are now thousands, hundreds of labs certainly in the world studying this, and we know that there are hundreds of different proteins involved in these processes in each human cell. Okay. So, personal journey 25 years ago, I just finished my postdoctoral work, or was getting towards the end of my postdoctoral work in Bob Tiedjian's lab in Berkeley, California. And I used to say a Friday afternoon experiment, but I checked my notebooks and it was actually a Saturday afternoon experiment because we used to work throughout the weekend in the lab. I came across this activity and it was an unexpected activity, and it was an activity which changed my whole career. So this was using extracts from, biochemical extracts from human HeLa cells, a cancer cell line that's been used by many for many, many years. And basically, I observed that the activity called DNA-PK. So DNA-PK stands for DNA-dependent or DNA-activated protein kinases. And as you'll know, protein kinases attach phosphorylation groups to target proteins. So the observation was that DNA-PK, an activity existed to phosphorylate certain target proteins, but it would only work when DNA was present in the test tube. So this is a Saturday afternoon experiment. I set up an experiment where I had DNA or no DNA, and then looked at the end of a reaction at my favorite protein, a protein called SP1. And when DNA was present, it was running higher on an SGS polyacrylamide gel. It had been phosphorylated. So that was an interesting observation. It led to me getting a cell, a paper in Cell, which helped my career. But in the materials and methods section, there was an observation that I didn't understand at the time. So this paper was published on the basis of DNA-dependent protein kinase activated by DNA, maybe playing a role in transcription. But one thing I couldn't figure out is that I'd observed that this kinase would only be active if a piece of DNA had DNA ends. By luck, when I did this Saturday afternoon experiment, I picked out of a test tube a piece of linear DNA. I was doing some cloning at the time. If I'd have used a circular piece of DNA in that experiment, the experiment would have been negative, and my whole career would have been totally different. So this is an amazing for me. I just happened to be cloning at the same time as I did this experiment. So DNA-PK is activated by linear DNA, not by circular DNA. When I set up my own lab and working with a Jewish graduate student, Tanya Gottlieb, Tanya and myself basically took things a step further. What we observed was that DNA-PK was made up of not just one protein, but three polypeptides. Two of those proteins are a protein called Ku. It had been identified many years earlier, and Ku is a DNA binding protein, but it requires DNA ends to bind DNA. And what we found is that DNA-PK, first of all, requires the Ku to bind DNA, and that it then recruits a large protein called DNA-PK-CS, DNA-PK catalytic subunit. This activates the kinase to phosphorylate its targets. Now, we made that observation together with Bill Dinan's lab in the US. We both found that DNA-PK needs the Ku protein to take it to DNA. But for us, the extra insight was the realization that DNA-PK requires DNA ends, and that's why it requires Ku, because Ku binds DNA ends, and several years later, This was shown by another group determining the crystal structure of Ku. So Ku basically is a donut shape, and it will only bind DNA when it can slide on to the DNA end. So the DNA-dependent protein kinase is a DNA end, double-strand break activated protein kinase. And this was a big eureka moment for my lab, because it suggested that DNAPK may be involved in DNA repair, and that set the lab off in this new direction. And I should just point out, a little bit later on, I'll talk about a company I set up called Qdos Pharmaceuticals, and the reason why I came up with the name Qdos, or my wife suggested the name, is that my whole career is based on what the Ku protein does. So Qdos is the name for the company. Okay, so moving into a new field, this was in the early to mid-1990s, I realized I knew nothing about the DNA repair field, so it was important to get collaborators. And very fortunately, I collaborated with Penny Jago's lab in Brighton, UK, and also Fred Ault in Harvard, USA. And collectively, and together with other researchers around the same time, we published a range of papers showing indeed that DNAPK is important for double-strand break repair. So cells without DNAPKCS or without the Ku protein are very sensitive to radiation because they cannot carry out the double-strand break repair pathway. Okay. At around the same time, or a little bit later, a few years later, Fred Ault's group identified another protein called XRCC4, which is also important in the same DNA repair pathway. And then using this, we and others established that this protein links together with a protein called DNA ligase 4. DNA ligase 4 does the final step of the double-strand break process. It basically pieces together, physically stitches together, the two DNA ends and restores DNA integrity. And with Tom Blundell next door in the Department of Biochemistry, we actually determined some crystal structures. So here you can see XRCC4 is a dimer. And we identified that DNA ligase 4 is basically binding to this region. This is just a part of DNA ligase 4. So this was the mid-1990s. My lab has been looking at various aspects of DNA repair and DNA damage response over the last few years. And in fact, we thought a few years ago that these were all of the components, all of the parts of this DNAPK-Ku-dependent DNA repair system called non-homologous end joining. But it turns out that it was actually very, very recently, we published last year in Science, again in collaboration with Tom Blundell, this is Takashi Ushi in Tom's lab, and Andrew Blackford, an English postdoc in my lab, who identified this new protein called PAX. And we think this is the final piece of this jigsaw. We think we now know all of the proteins involved in double-strand break repair via the non-homologous end joining system. And it was very interesting to note that the PAX protein actually works through a very conserved C-terminal motif. And this C-terminal motif, which is conserved in many, many organisms, actually binds to Ku. So we started out on non-homologous end joining by identifying this pathway through Ku. And we are now, finally, we think we've identified the last factor. And that completes the circle because we believe that this factor is very, very important in binding Ku. So Ku binds to one double-strand break, it binds to the other double-strand break, and we think a key function for PAX is to bridge those two DNA ends through binding to Ku and hold them together so that XRCC4, ligase 4, and DNAPK can then process the ends and piece them together again. So, of course, going from 1990, 1991 through to 2015 is almost 25 years. So my lab has essentially been looking at this pathway, trying to understand these factors for many years. We think we know all the proteins, but of course that's not the end of the journey. There's still much to do. For example, we don't really know how all the factors that we already know about work. So we have many challenges still ahead to try and understand precisely how they work. But also, we believe that there are additional factors that regulate DNA repair. And so many members of my lab over the last 10 years have been searching for new factors, new proteins that regulate DNA repair. And just in that regard, I just want to highlight that although we initially identified Ku and DNAPK as controlling double-strand break repair, a number of years ago, we cloned the cDNA for DNAPKCS. And this was another eureka moment. Because in 1995, we cloned DNA-PKCS, and the same year, a number of researchers, headed by Yossi Schilo, identified the ATM protein. And it turns out that ATM is a protein kinase, and DNA-PK and ATM are highly related. And through work in our lab and other labs, we now know that ATM is not just physically like DNA-PK, it functions like DNA-PK. So we now know that the ATM is also a DNA damage activated protein kinase, but it's not recruited to double strand breaks via Ku, it's recruited to DNA damage by another protein complex called the mRNA complex. And ATM affects DNA repair, but what it does mainly is to control many other activities within the cell in response to DNA damage, including cell proliferation, in some cases cell death, and cell senescence. And it's very strongly connected to P53. It's also important to note that defects in ATM cause a disease in humans called ataxia telangiectasia, which is a neurodegenerative cancer predisposition syndrome. Just as an aside, we know that defects in non-homologous end joining also occur in people. This causes radiation sensitivity, some cancer predisposition, but also immune deficiency, because our immune system, the B and T cells, they recognize foreign antigens by T cell receptors and antibody molecules. And it turns out that the vast repertoire of the binding capabilities of antibodies and T cell receptors is generated by our immune cells deliberately generating breaks and piecing together parts of the genome in different ways to give this diversity. So cells lacking DNA-PK or Ku cannot carry out repair of double-strand breaks caused by radiation, but they also cannot carry out the proper repair of these breaks generated in our immune system. And that's why cells and also people and mice, for that matter, without DNA-PK-Q, have immune deficiency. Another protein kinase related to DNA-PK and ATM is the protein ATR. And to cut a long story short, working in a number of labs, Steve Elliger's lab was very important in this, but also our lab, have shown that this is also a DNA damage-activated protein kinase, these phosphorylate proteins. In this case, a defect in ATR gives rise to a developmental disorder in people called Seckle syndrome. Okay. So DNA-PK, ATM, and ATR have really highlighted how phosphorylation, protein kinases, play a very important role in repair and this broader DNA damage response. But of course, we know that phosphorylation is one of the key ways of controlling protein activity, but there are many others. So proteins are made in cells. They sometimes have intrinsic functions that are just constitutively active. But in many, many cases, the activities of proteins, as you'll know, are controlled by post-translational modifications, and phosphorylation is just one of those. So over the years, my lab and other labs in the field have learned that other modifications, such as methylation on histones and non-histone proteins, we know that protein acetylation, deacetylation, modifications such as poly-ADP ribosylation, and also things such as ubiquitination and sumoylation control these DNA damage responses. And of course, these same modifications in other guises control most other activities inside of our cells. So over the last few years, in addition to studying protein kinases, my lab's also been studying these other modifications and trying to connect them together. And in that regard, we've been particularly interested in ubiquitination and sumoylation. I won't go into this in detail, but I just want to highlight that ubiquitination and the related process of sumoylation have the potential to be even more biologically important than phosphorylation. And certainly phosphorylation has been studied much, much more than ubiquitination. So what is ubiquitination? Ubiquitin is a post-translational modification, but it actually is a little protein itself. It's a 76 amino acid residue protein, which is covalently attached to target proteins, often through lysine residues. Ubiquitination occurs through a cascade of enzymes called E1, E2, and E3 enzymes that work together to regulate the activity of various targets. There are many proteins involved in ubiquitination. There are more proteins involved in ubiquitination than there are controlling phosphorylation and dephosphorylation. So we know ubiquitination is complex. It's even more complex than other modifications because whereas phosphorylation, acetylation, methylation are just basically the attachment of one group or not. For ubiquitination, in many cases, you can have single ubiquitination, where just one ubiquitin is attached to a protein. You can also have multiple single ubiquitins attached to a protein. But in some cases, sorry, I've done that again, you can end up with ubiquitin chains. And so in this regard, sorry, you can end up with ubiquitin chains of various lengths. You can also end up with branch chains of different types. So ubiquitination has the potential to be much more diverse in its functions than other post-translational modifications. And like other post-translational modifications, it's reversible. So it's reversed by the actions of these purple proteins called dubs, which trim and remove and reverse ubiquitination. So for the last few years, my lab has been carrying out screens. We're doing focus screens, siRNA screens, but we're now using CRISPR-Cas9 technologies and other technologies to focus on dubs and also E2 enzymes, but also E3s. And what we're doing, often using microscopy as well as biochemistry and cell biology, is to systematically analyze the over 1,000 proteins involved in ubiquitination for their effects in DNA repair. And over the last few years, we've made a number of publications in that regard, and we're also now thinking about therapeutic applications. So what are these therapeutic applications or potential applications for DNA repair and related areas? Okay. Well, if you think about it for a moment, all of the enzymes that are involved in attaching and removing these post-translational modifications could be drug targets. And we know in oncology in particular, in cancer, protein kinases have been targeted by the pharmaceutical industry for the last 2 to 3 decades. So on paper, it would now be possible to come up with molecules, drugs, that could interfere with DNA repair. And that was a concept behind a company called Qdos that I founded in 1997 with the help of the University of Cambridge. And the concept behind Qdos was to carry out high-throughput chemical screens together with associated technologies to identify drugs, to inhibit DNA repair and the broader DNA damage response. So I thought this was a great idea. I was a young professor in the University of Cambridge. I was told I was the youngest professor in Cambridge since Isaac Newton, so I had very big aspirations for myself. But the response was not very positive. I talked to Cancer Research UK, a charity. I also talked to pharmaceutical companies about my ideas. And of course, they didn't think it was a very good idea, because why would you want to inhibit DNA repair? DNA repair is good. DNA repair protects against disease, cancer, neurodegenerative disease, even aging. Why would you want to get drugs to inhibit DNA repair? So I had these ideas in my head, but it took a couple of years, almost 18 months, almost 2 years, to really put them down on presentation in paper in a way that, in the end, got the venture capital groups to invest in the company, into the Qdos concept. So in the end, I agree, inhibiting DNA repair is not going to be a good thing for a healthy person, but in a diseased person, you can imagine how DNA repair inhibitors might be quite useful. So for example, you might be able to use DNA repair inhibitors together with existing cancer therapies to enhance their efficiency to kill cancer cells. But of course, the problem here is that you might also increase the toxicity to normal cells of the body. Now, what you really want in cancer therapy is to identify a way to kill the cancer cells without killing the normal cells in the body. That is the holy grail of cancer therapy. How could you use DNA repair inhibition to do this? Well, even in the mid-1990s, in the late 1990s, it was already clear that many cancers rely on DNA repair pathways more than normal cells. So this could be their Achilles heel. So cancer cells are often dividing and replicating more than normal cells. They're going through the cell cycle, they're replicating their DNA. And they're in very vulnerable phases more often. So DNA replication and cell division are very vulnerable in the presence of DNA damage. So you could imagine that cancer cells will be more susceptible than normal cells. Often cancer cells are growing and dividing when they should not. They're growing in the absence of sufficient or normal levels of oxygenation. They're also racing through the cell cycle without the correct controls in place. So this actually turns out to be the case that when you look at cancer cells and even precursors to cancer, they're often exhibiting higher levels of DNA damage than normal cells. So that could also be an Achilles heel. Another opportunity is that it turns out that very early in progression towards cancer, many cancer cells or precursors to cancer lose certain DNA repair pathways. And that allows the cancer cell or the precursor to cancer cells to then accumulate more mutations, because you need many mutations to give rise to cancer. And that was a key concept behind QDOS. And that links me to this genetic principle I talked about at the beginning. And we could talk about it in that regard, but let's instead look at it in a little bit more of a straightforward way. So if you can imagine a normal cell in the body has two ways of repairing a double strand break or another DNA damage. If you take away one of those, the cell can still deal with that. If you take away the other, the cell can deal with that. If you take away both, I won't do it with my legs, obviously, that is not so good. So the concept behind QDOS, one of the concepts, was to take this genetic principle and translate it into pharmacology. So the idea here is that if a cancer cell has lost pathway B, this cancer cell is very reliant on pathway A, more reliant than the normal cell. So if instead of inactivating the gene, if we could come up with a drug to inhibit the product of gene A, we would selectively kill the cancer cell, but not the normal cell. So that's one of the principles behind QDOS, and that in the end is the principle that we've taken most far. So QDOS was a company, it ran for several years. I was a part-time chief scientific officer, so I kept my job at the University of Cambridge, but approximately, to start with, 50% of my time. By the end, it was more like 10% of my time. I was the chief scientific officer of the company. Obviously, companies need a number of people, management all the way through. I was very fortunate to recruit and then pass over my responsibilities to very talented individuals. The company raised quite a bit of money in the end, and in the end was acquired by AstraZeneca. So the company never grew too large, but it was essentially a fully integrated drug discovery company. We had biologists, we had high throughput screening, we had medicinal chemistry, and we had early phase clinical development. Okay. So to cut a long story short, QDOS was able to generate several compounds, many of which are used in the research literature, but in the very near future, four compounds developed by QDOS are now in clinical trials, and they're in clinical trials by the company AstraZeneca, which acquired QDOS for $210 million in 2005-2006. So QDOS then for several years ran as a subsidiary of AstraZeneca, with me still as chief scientist. But eventually AstraZeneca, as do all big drug companies, they decide to do something dramatic. They close down QDOS and transferred all of the activities to their other site in the UK. So several of my colleagues moved over to AstraZeneca. Several of my colleagues are now moving back to Cambridge because AstraZeneca has recently decided to move its entire world operations outside of the US into Cambridge. And I don't know if QDOS was a part of that reasoning, but I think AstraZeneca is now moved to Cambridge because, well, they feel that to be a good pharmaceutical company, they need to connect with basic researchers. And I think that's going to be a very, very good relationship for the company, but also for academics in Cambridge. So although AstraZeneca has been running these programs for the last number of years, and I've not been associated with them, these compounds arose within QDOS, and of course, they're very dear to my heart, and also those of my various colleagues. Okay. So I won't talk about all of the programs. These are against the ATM, ATR proteins, a related protein called mTOR, but I'm just going to really leave with you today where things are with the QDOS compound called olaparib, which QDOS developed and formulated which is now in the clinic and actually is treating patients. So Graham Smith, who was a postdoc in my group, so he was an academic scientist, he transferred into the company and he's now working for AstraZeneca. Neil Martin, a colleague that I recruited from industry into QDOS and is now associated with another company I've set up, I'll mention in a moment, together with a range of other individuals within QDOS, developed this compound here called olaparib, or AZD2281. This is a very potent and highly selective small molecule drug which inhibits this enzyme called PARP. PARP is a DNA damage activated enzyme. It's not a protein kinase, it's a poly-ADP ribose polymerase. It's a very complicated process, but what basically PARP does, a little bit like Ku and DNA-PK, PARP binds to, is activated by single-strand breaks and double-strand breaks in DNA. This triggers the activity of PARP, and basically then it carries out a chemical reaction, takes nicotine adenine dinucleotide, and takes the ADP ribose group of that and attaches it to itself and also to other proteins as branched chains. What we've known through work, not in my lab, but in other labs, including Thomas Lindahl, who received the Nobel Prize for Chemistry last year, is that PARP catalyzes another DNA repair process called single-strand break repair. Okay. So QDOS developed olaparib and related compounds to inhibit PARP, and this slows down single-strand break repair and base excision repair. Now, this type of repair process is occurring in every one of our cells all the time. So what happens when you treat cells, normal cells or cancer cells, with PARP inhibitors, like olaparib, is that it traps the PARP on the DNA, it slows down single-strand break repair. Now, single-strand breaks are not nice, the cell does need to deal with them, but of course if you treat the cells with a drug, when you take the drug away, those single-strand breaks can be repaired. Single-strand breaks are not very toxic. Only one strand of the DNA double helix is broken. And when the drug disappears, because most drugs get excreted or metabolized, the repair occurs. So single-strand breaks are not very toxic. But if you replicate a chromosome with a single-strand break, when the DNA polymerase encounters that single-strand break, it will generate a double-strand break. And as I told you at the beginning, double-strand breaks are very, very toxic. One unrepaired double-strand break can be sufficient to kill a cell, human cell, or a mouse cell, or a yeast cell. But it turns out that when you treat cells with olaparib, these single-strand breaks occur in a context which is a perfect substrate for the other double-strand break repair system. Not the non-homologous end-joining system, but a system called homologous recombination. Homologous recombination works very, very well when a double-strand break is generated alongside a perfect copy with a non-double-strand break. And if you think about it for a moment, if you replicate a chromosome with a single-strand break, you'll generate a double-strand break from this top strand, but the other strand of the DNA can be copied. So homologous recombination turns out to be a perfect system to effectively repair the DNA damage caused by olaparib. The system that repairs this DNA damage is a complicated process called homologous recombination. And key features of homologous recombination is that in S phase, in these kind of situations, it's very efficient, and it's also very, very accurate. So the damage caused by olaparib and other S phase agents like olaparib is accurately repaired. So the DNA molecules look as if they've never been damaged. Other key features of homologous recombination, which is a very, very complicated process, my lab's played a range of roles in this over the years, for example, identifying several of these factors. But two of the factors that are very, very important are factors called BRCA1 and BRCA2. Cells without BRCA1 or BRCA2 cannot effectively mediate this pathway. What are BRCA1 and BRCA2? Well, BRCA1 and 2 are genes that when deficient give rise to breast, ovarian, but also a range of other cancers. We now know, including prostate cancer, as well as pancreatic cancer, and others. Okay. So at this stage, we thought there might be opportunities for PARP inhibitors in BRCA-deficient cancers. So the QDOS team teamed up with Professor Alan Ashworth in London whom I met at a conference, and we basically decided to test in some of the cellular models that Alan has established whether or not PARP inhibitors had a potential. So this is really the only data I'm going to show you today, but it really was another eureka moment for us, was these data here. And I'll just spend a couple of minutes explaining these. What we're looking at here are three curves, one, two, three, and the x-axis is increasing concentration of a PARP inhibitor from QDOS. And I'll point out that this is a log plot, so every step here is tenfold. On the y-axis is surviving proportion of cells, again on a log axis, so going from here to here represents a thousandfold difference. And you notice that these three curves are very, very different from one another. Well, what are they? These are the curves of different cell lines exposed to increasing concentrations of olaparib, or a precursor to olaparib. These cells on the right are cells that have two copies of BRCA2, so BRCA2 plus plus. These cells here are BRCA2 plus minus. They have one bad copy, one good copy of BRCA2, and they behave very, very similarly to the wild-type BRCA2 cells. The third line here are BRCA2 minus minus cells. And you can see that these are basically over a thousandfold more sensitive to PARP inhibitors than the other two. And that will work two ways. If you use a certain concentration of PARP inhibitor, this one here, you'll get a thousandfold preferential killing of these cells. On another way, you can see that you could kill these cells with a thousandfold lower amounts of PARP inhibitor than normal cells. So at the same time, we published our studies in Nature, and another group, Thomas Halliday, Nicholas Curtin, published their related findings in Nature. Why were we so excited by these findings? Well, these findings, we thought, might actually identify clinical opportunity, because it turns out that women, we now know men, who inherit bad copies of BRCA1 and BRCA2, they inherit just one bad copy. So a BRCA mutant carrier individual has one wild-type copy from mother or father, but one bad copy. But when you look at the cancers arising in these patients, they tend to have lost the normal copy, so they become minus-minus. So thinking of this in the context of the patient, you can imagine if this is a BRCA carrier lady, the normal cells in her body will be plus minus. So you could imagine that those cells would be relatively resistant to a PARP inhibitor such as olaparib. However, in the cancer cell that's lost the wild type copy, these cells would now be BRCA deficient, deficient in homologous recombination, and therefore might be very susceptible to PARP inhibitors. So this for us was a concept we decided to exploit. And even in the early phase clinical trials, so AstraZeneca acquired QDOS at the very end, just before the new year in 2005. Already by 2006, mid-2006, the phase one clinical trials, which, you know, phase one trials are normally just to check that your drug is not too toxic, that it gets to the right target organs, we're already seeing responses. So here you can see a very large tumor mass decreasing in this lady, another tumor mass decreasing in this lady here. And in the patients that were responding, this was an all-comer trial, invariably these patients had family histories. And that is one of the key characteristics of BRCA1, BRCA mutations. They tend to run in families. So this was very exciting. And basically, the follow-on studies going to phase two confirmed that cancers deficient in BRCA1 or BRCA2, in many cases, but not in all cases, are selectively killed by olaparib. So I was very pleased in 2006, 2007, because the company I'd established had identified a drug, we'd formulated it. With our academic collaborators, we'd identified a therapeutic opportunity. And we'd sold the company to AstraZeneca, which had a lot of money to develop the clinical trials. But unfortunately, things didn't go so smoothly for a number of reasons. One of the reasons was big companies tend to think sometimes a little bit too big. The science, of course, was saying you should try this in the first instance on these specific patients with BRCA mutations. The big company, and I guess the commercial opportunity, was we'll try all ovarian cancer, we'll try all breast cancer. And of course, when you run trials like that, not very many patients respond. So on the basis of that, in 2012, AstraZeneca actually cancelled, they closed down the olaparib program because the clinical trials were not working. But fortunately, some of my ex-QDOS colleagues and also some AstraZeneca colleagues were not going to give up. They carried on analyzing the data. And in those broader phase two studies with their colleagues, they then showed that the few patients that did respond were, of course, the ones with the BRCA mutations. And with a change at the top, the chief executive changed in AstraZeneca, who came in with a fresh perspective. He decided, this is crazy, we haven't tested this drug properly. And he then pressed the button to reevaluate that phase two and ultimately phase three trial. And on the basis of that, just over, 18 months ago now, olaparib finally received registration by the FDA and also the European Medicines Agency. And olaparib now is an available therapy for advanced ovarian cancer in over 40 countries within the world. So this is the first in-class drug targeting PARPs. It's the first drug in the world that works by this synthetic lethality mechanism, taking advantage of an Achilles heel of cancer cells. And as far as I'm aware, it's the first cancer drug in the world that works by targeting an inherited cancer predisposition, which many of these patients do. Okay. So just to end up with a little bit on a more personal note, these are the kind of data that clinicians are now looking at. They're looking at for ovarian cancer, the patients over here, this is the amount of time to progress on disease. Many of these patients are not being cured. They can simply be on olaparib, which is very non-toxic, before going on to the later stages of their cancer therapy. But one thing that the regulators have not looked at so far, but me, as I consider olaparib to be my baby, my colleagues as well, and also clinicians, are very interested at looking as these trials progress. Because it turns out that if you look after 2 or 3 years, there are many patients who are not progressing in their disease on the olaparib side, whereas the placebo, they are. So currently, it's now clear that over 17% of these patients, after 3 years, their disease has not progressed. Whereas on the placebo, this is almost down to zero. In fact, many of those patients then now move on to the olaparib side of the trial. So there's a lot of excitement now that there may be very long-term responses and possible cures for many of these patients. And of course, these are late-stage patients, so the potential, if the drug could be used even earlier, the chances may be even higher. So AstraZeneca is set to make lots of money out of this, which is good for business. I won't make a single penny, a single cent out of this. I made a little bit of money when QDOS was sold. But the reason why I'm excited by this is that if you do the maths, it says that basically AstraZeneca is expecting tens of thousands of patients to benefit from this drug. There's also other opportunities in other cancer areas, pancreatic, breast, and other and also in combinations. This is a trial that's currently running in Asia, looking at gastric cancer, and this is the proportion of patients alive in a combination trial without or with olaparib. So there's a lot of excitement here. Of course, clinical trials take many years. Finally, there's very recently been some data suggesting or indicating that up to 30% of advanced metastatic terminal prostate cancer will respond to olaparib. And I think this highlights the idea that if you initially identify a disease through a genetic disease, if you could develop a therapy against that genetic disease, in this case BRCA1 or BRCA2, you can then start thinking about broader populations. In this case, these are not, in most cases, inherited predisposition. This is somatic loss of BRCA1 or BRCA2 in men with prostate cancer. So the hope is that this same therapy that was developed for breast and ovarian cancer may also find utility in prostate cancer. And very, very recently, just a few weeks ago, the US FDA basically pressed the button in terms of a breakthrough therapy designation in prostate cancer. This doesn't mean that olaparib will be successful in prostate cancer. It just means the FDA is very seriously and in a very rapid mode now evaluating that possibility. So I think olaparib highlights a very big potential. I think there are many other potentials, not just for PARP inhibitors, but also for other inhibitors of DNA repair. Not just PARPs, not just kinases. I set up a few years ago with my ex-colleague, a Kudos colleague, Neil Martin, a company called Mission Therapeutics. As for Kudos, I'm part-time chief scientific officer for Mission. And what Mission is targeting is these ubiquitination pathways to come up for new treatments for cancer and other diseases. And in fact, Mission's most exciting target right now is actually potentially against Parkinson's disease. So this is my academic lab at the University of Cambridge. It's not quite so sunny there so often, but occasionally we can find a sunny day to take a photo. This is outside the Gurdon Institute, a very international, diverse set of researchers. As I've mentioned, a couple of them along the way, including, say, Jews, Muslims, Christians, and also people of no faith. We're a very diverse group, and it works most of the time very, very well. I just finally want to end up with, and this is just going to be a couple of minutes, what I'm very excited about. Of course, receiving a prize like the King Faisal Prize is a major achievement for my whole career. But anybody who knows me well have known over the years that when I achieve a certain level, my mind is immediately thinking about what next. I've been working in this area for 25 years. I'm now 53 years old. But when I see Professor Sir John Gurdon still running an active lab after a Nobel Prize and being in his mid-80s, I realize that there is, health permitting, the possibility that I may have another 25 years. So if I even have a few years, what could I do with them? And I think having an international prize like this potentially gives me an opportunity to maybe command a little bit more attention and maybe identify some bigger opportunities. And that's what I'm spending a lot of time about at the moment, talking to potential funders. And I think I've already established, hopefully to you, that strong basic research, as is going on here, in the end can work very, very well in a synergistic way with commerce, with business. They're not mutually exclusive. And I think at the moment is particularly a great time to be thinking about new opportunities. We're in the midst of a revolution in the life sciences. We have iPS cells, we have genome engineering with CRISPR-Cas9. Labs like mine can do things that we wouldn't have even imagined was possible a few years ago. We also know much more about disease, and in particular we know much more about genetic diseases. We know about genetic diseases that cause cancer, but we also know about genetic diseases that cause many other diseases. And just like in cancer, understanding genetic diseases of various types could also give insights into sporadic disease that are operating via similar mechanisms. So we're also in a situation not only knowing the genetics of disease, but in the lab we can create genetic models of disease in very effective ways. And we know gene dysfunction causes diseases. 1 in 16 people in the UK, that's what I say to my funder, the Wellcome Trust and Cancer Research UK, is associated with a genetic disease in terms of their lifetime. And out of this knowledge is becoming, I think, rising expectations from patients, their families, funding bodies, and the government. So how can it be that understanding the genetics of disease like cancer and other diseases can be translated to therapeutics? I think I've highlighted one example today, but I think there are many, many others. And the final thing I'll leave you with today is this genetic principle that I started out with. The two ends of the spectrum are synthetic lethality, which we've taken advantage of pharmacologically with PARP inhibitors, but there is also the other end of the spectrum, this genetic suppression. And over half of my lab is now working on this, and this is an increasing focus of my lab, is to focus on this, and again, to try and translate it into pharmacology. So this is the principle here. The idea here is that a gene defect gives rise to a disease. If we can identify a gene B that, if targeted genetically or its product pharmacologically, will rebalance the disease, then that could also be a therapeutic strategy. Maybe this sounds like an unlikely idea, but the more we learn about biology, I think we realize that disease often occurs not because the cell and the body doesn't do something, but because the cell or body does too much of something or does the wrong thing. And if you realize that, I think the idea of thinking about diseases as being about imbalances in the cell becomes to the fore. And if you identify the source of an imbalance and then can find ways to screen for ways to rebalance this phenotype through these types of principles, I think you have opportunities for thinking about new therapeutics. Okay, so that's the focus of my lab and what I'm talking to, particularly the Wellcome Trust at the present time. I'm having a big presentation with them next month that I hope to convince them that they should launch a new initiative, principally within the UK, called the Darwin Initiative for Disease Biology, to take advantage of evolutionary and genetic principles to systematically screen for novel therapies for a range of diseases with genetic contents. So the idea for this new initiative is to harness cellular, chemical, genetic, and evolutionary principles to better understand disease. And I think this is a massive opportunity that I hope to convince the Wellcome Trust to initially carry out the funding. I'm sorry I've gone over slightly, but I'll thank you for your attention. Thanks. Well, thank you for the comment and the question, both of which I absolutely agree with. Before answering the question, I think that 25 years is a short period of time, but it's also for an individual a long period of time. And I think that the challenge ahead for many countries is to have a long enough term vision, because it's very difficult to take basic science and translate that to new medicines overnight. And what I see when I'm traveling around Saudi Arabia now is a country that is ambitious and hopefully I believe has a long-term vision, hopefully building not just the infrastructure but the people, because all of this in the end is based on educated people, and that's what I'm seeing when I'm visiting Saudi Arabia. So I think the prospects are very strong here. Your question. It's not going to be simple to translate this insight, but I think in the end, most diseases, not all diseases, most diseases arise because of defects that arise within the cell, environmental as well as genetic influences. I think in the end, if you can identify a condition and relate to that to a fundamental process, for example, ataxia telangiectasia is a disease my lab is working on. It's cancer predisposition, it's neurodegeneration, but when you look at the cellular level, you can identify that at the level of DNA repair. So I think if you can have a genetic condition identified through next-gen sequencing of families or affected individuals, in the end, if you can drive that towards a molecular understanding, a cellular understanding, at least then you know what is wrong. In some cases, it may not be possible to fix it or correct it or rebalance it, but in other cases, I think it will be possible. And then the challenge is to, and this is what my lab is now really focusing on in our focused area, is to build cellular models that we can then use to screen drugs or screen genetic factors to correct the phenotype. If you identify that, then the next step is to ask, is this a druggable target? Maybe there are already existing drugs. I think that is an interesting idea. Pharmaceutical companies have developed many drugs, and many of the drugs that they've developed in oncology, but have not been successful, are also the kinds of drugs which are associated with a range of other diseases. So I think in some cases, you may identify a druggable target and then need to do a whole drug discovery process. But in other circumstances, the drug may already exist. And with the right people working together with the right patient groups, it might be possible to accelerate the evaluation of that compound. I don't think it will be simple. Of course, it's an international effort, I think, and we're all very, very connected in this regard. It's wonderful to see what's going on here. Also, my colleagues at the Sanger Institute, Genomics England, and I think we need to talk to each other to make the most of these opportunities. Now, that's a great question, because in the end, not just for cancer but other therapies, in the end it's combination of drugs which work best. If you can identify a standalone opportunity, it's a little bit easier to do a clinical trial, because you just have one variable. You have to find the dose of your drug. So olaparib has been taken into combination trials, and they are showing promise. The problem there is you go in with your drug, and then you have to probably reduce the amount of of therapy that already exists, and that just makes the clinical trials more difficult to run ethically. But I think there is a big opportunity there. In the end, it's about identifying a therapeutic window. So if you, for example, could find that you could reduce the level of a cytotoxic chemotherapy and reduce side effects while still having potential on the cancer cells, that's a great prospect. So those things are being evaluated, but they take longer. Of course, the scientists in AstraZeneca are just as clever as scientists in my lab. I think that there is still challenges to couple together science with business. And in the end, a successful business in science has to listen to the scientists. And of course, if the scientists also need to think about the business, it's a two-way relationship. But I think progress is being made. Absolutely, some BRCA mutations are stronger than others, and so that will affect the response. Related to that, we do know, if you look at all those curves, we know that there are patients with BRCA mutations that do not respond to olaparib. So why is that? That then goes back to this synthetic viability principle, so there are resistance pathways in cancers. So you treat most cancers with most agents, even if they initially respond, there is a selection pressure for evolution of resistance. And we need to understand those resistance pathways as well as understanding the different kinds of BRCA mutations. Again, if you understand resistance pathways, maybe that identifies another opportunity, possibly for a combination treatment that would kill cells with the resistance mechanism. So cancer is going to be a moving target. It's not going to be cured overnight. I think the earlier we use compounds like olaparib, the chances are better. But of course, resistance, different types of mutations are going to be a challenge, and we need to understand this.